Hello, learners. I, Dr. Ritu Gupta, am today again welcoming you to the world of economics. Today, we are going to understand the Indian economy, what it was just before independence, and how over the years it has grown. So let us now get started with an overview of Indian economy. What you will learn today is the characteristics or features of the Indian economy, problems faced by the Indian economy, the role of agriculture in India, and growth of industry in India. So let us go through them one by one, beginning with characteristics or features of the Indian economy. Every economy in the world has its own characteristics or features by which it is known or identified. Economies are compared with each other on the basis of these features. These features, as we will go by, are many as identified for India. India as a distinct nation came into existence on 15th of August 1947, called the Independence Day of India, which marked the end of the British era or the British rule over India. Independent India has completed nearly 7 decades of self-rule, a period long enough to evaluate the position and performance of the country and to enable comparison with other countries in the world, as well as evaluate its own progress over the years. Let us now go through the features one by one. First, we will just mark these features and then we will go into each of their details. The first feature of the Indian economy is that it has a low per capita income. Secondly, there is heavy population pressure. Thirdly, there is dependence of population on agriculture. And it's not just dependence, it is heavy dependence. And fourth, there is poverty and inequality in income distribution. There is something good also, that there is a higher level of capital formation, a definite positive feature, and the fact that India is a planned economy. So we plan to reach certain goals. Let us now study the first feature, which is the low per capita income. India is known in the world as a country with low per capita income. Per capita income is defined as the ratio of national income over population. It gives the idea about the average earning of an Indian citizen in a year, even though this may not reflect the actual earning of each individual. And here comes the role of distribution, which is unequal. So we may find some people actually earning much more while others little or none. But still, the role of average low per capita income is strongly felt. India's per capita income for the year 2012-13 is estimated at ₹39,168. This comes to about 3,264 per month. If we compare India's per capita income with other countries of the world, then it can be seen that India is well behind many of them. India is world's second largest populated country after China. As per 2011 census, India's population stands at more than 121 crores. It increased at a rate of 1.03% during the decade 1990 to 2001. I repeat, an annual average increase of 1.03% in the rate of growth of population. And that is why we have a heavy population pressure on the Indian economy. Let us now understand why this population has been increasing. The main cause of fast rise in India's population is the sharp decline in death rate, while the birth rate has not decreased as fast. As a result, the gap between the death rate and the birth rate has gone on widening. The death rate is defined as the number of people died per 1,000 of population, while birth rate is defined as the number of people taking birth per 1,000 of population. So we have a decreasing death rate and a ever decreasing birth rate, but at a lower rate. This brings us to the third feature of the Indian economy, that is the dependence on agriculture. Let us see what this feature tells us about the Indian economy. Majority of India's working population depend on agricultural activities to pursue their livelihood. In 2011, about 58% of India's working population was engaged in agriculture, and this is a large percentage. In spite of this, the contribution of agriculture to India's gross domestic product is just as little as only around 17%, which means that many people are depending on agriculture, but the output from agriculture is very low. And this tells us something very, very deep about the condition of agriculture in India, which we shall be discussing subsequently. A major concern then is that productivity of this sector is very less. There are many reasons for this. That is, why is agriculture in India having low productivity? I'm sure you have your own ideas, but let's see what our subject experts have to give to you. Firstly, there is heavy population pressure on land to sustain the huge number. Hence, the per capita availability of land area is very low and not viable for extracting higher output. This causes low productivity of agriculture. The second reason for low productivity of agriculture is that a majority of people are forced to become agricultural labor working at low wages. This is because per capita land availability is less, so many people are forced to fall back on agriculture land as their means of output. And this again leads to overcrowding in agriculture. The next reason is that Indian agriculture suffers from lack of better technology and irrigation facilities. Technology would lead to increase in output, and irrigation facilities would lead to less dependence on monsoons. So with both these lacking, naturally, there would be low productivity of agriculture. There is yet another reason for this low productivity, and that is that people who are not educated or not trained properly are engaged in agriculture. So this also leads to low productivity in this sector. To sum this up, let us say that there is low productivity of agriculture due to per capita land availability being low. There is lack of better technology and irrigation facilities, and uneducated or untrained people are engaged in agriculture. Having established this, let us now also understand one more thing about agriculture, and that is the role of agriculture in India. Agriculture is one of the most important sectors of the Indian economy. This can be established with the following pointers: that it is the supplier of food and raw materials in the country. All the food that we eat and all the raw materials such as cotton, jute and other mining activity output are supplied by agricultural sector. At the time of independence, more than 70% of India's population depended on agriculture to earn their livelihood. However, the share of agriculture in the national product or income was high, but not as high enough as the 70% engaged. It was as high as 56.6% in 1950-51. However, with development of industries and service sector during the plan periods, the percentage of population depending on agriculture as well as the share of agriculture in the national product has come down. So we find that over the years, the number of people depending on agriculture though have increased, but the percentage of population depending on agriculture has fallen, and so has the share of agriculture in the national product. In 1960, the percentage of labor force engaged in agricultural activities was 74, which gradually came down over the years to 51% in 2012. The same goes that in 1960, the share of labor force in industry and service sectors stood at 11 and 15% respectively, but in 2012, it has definitely increased because the share of agriculture has declined. So here are some statistics to prove our point. Now, what about the feature of poverty and inequality in the Indian economy? Another very disheartening thing about India is that it has the world's largest number of poor people. As per reports of Government of India, in 2011-12, about 269.3 million people in India were poor. This was about 22% of India's population. Imagine having such a large percentage of its population as poor. This is a very large percentage. Now we need to identify how we term a person as poor or non-poor. A person is termed poor if he or she is not able to consume the required amount of food to get a minimum calorie value of 2,400 in rural areas and 2,100 in urban areas. So a person who cannot get enough food to be able to ingest or to be able to take in these many calories, depending upon the place of stay, whether urban or rural, then we call that person as poor. Translating in this to money terms, a person must earn the required amount of money as well to buy the food items. The government has also estimated that the required amount of money is rupees 816 in rural areas and rupees 1000 in urban areas per head per month, that is to provide the requisite calories of 2400 in rural areas and 2100 in urban areas. This comes to about rupees 28 in rural area and rupees 33 in urban area per head per day. This is called the poverty line. This implies that 269.9 million people of India were not able to earn such little amount in 2011 and 12. Yes, you must be wondering, has this percentage fallen? It has, but to a very low extent. Let us now move to the next feature of the Indian economy, which is a high rate of capital formation or investment. At the time of independence, one of the major problems of Indian economy was deficiency in capital stock in the form of land and building, machinery and equipment, savings, etc. in the form of capital assets or capital stock for the entire nation. In order to continue the cycle of economic activities such as production and consumption, a certain ratio of production must go towards saving and investment. However, the required ratio was never generated in the first 4 to 5 decades after independence. That means in the first 5 decades, the Indian economy was growing but with a very low rate of capital formation. This brings us to the fifth feature of the Indian economy, which is the growth of industry in India. Industry, or the secondary sector of the economy, is another important area of economic activity. After independence, the government of India emphasized the role of industrialization in the country's economic development in the long run. Industry, as we know, is the one which provides us with manufactured goods. Accordingly, the blueprint for industrial development was made through the Industrial Policy Resolution, IPR, in 1956. The 1956 policy emphasized on establishment of heavy industries, with public sector taking the lead in this area. Adoption of heavy or basic industries strategy was justified on the ground that it will reduce the burden on agriculture, enable growth in the production of consumer goods industries, as well as small industries that are helpful for employment generation and achieving self-reliance. Indian industry has, since then, recorded tremendous growth, but not as much as the service sector. Let us quickly recall what we have studied in this session. We first studied the characteristics or features of the Indian economy, the problems faced by the Indian economy, the role of agriculture in India, and growth of industry in India. I hope with this your understanding of the Indian economy has become deeper and better. Thank you very much. I, Dr. Ritu Gupta, will be glad to be back with you very soon with other topics in economics. Thank you and all the best.